Negative, correct?
Is it negative x?
So it's negative, well...
4x, oh, so it's negative 4.
So that's what you're divided by, right?
Oh, yeah.
Because your coefficient's negative.
So it's supposed to be x, but it has to be different. 3 divided by negative.
Exactly. Don't forget about those negatives. They have feelings, too.
Oh, yeah.
Mostly negative feelings, but you still don't want to hurt them. That's it, yeah.
If I'm not a negative, I don't know why.
You're not a negative.
Oh, God.
It's perfect. So was that, Andy. Nice job. Okay, Stephen P., you can put up one. Let me just make sure you get the right answer. Yeah, you did it. That's beautiful. Yes, you may do two. All right, class. Power of positive thinking, right? Mm-hmm. How's today going to be?
Great.
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 Positive.
Positive.
I got that feeling.
Phenomenal.
Inside my bones.
Nice. Nice.
Wait, oh yeah. Zay, how did you do? Perfect. Nope. So we're in front of a 3 again. That's a constant, right? But that term is a variable. They're not alike. So.
Can I put the 7 on?
I already gave that one to Alex. I love it. Alright, where's the variable? Which side? So the. Well. Draw a line on the equal sign, makes it easier. What side of the equal sign is it? The left side, good. So we need to get rid of the constant that's also on the left side. So positive thing. Exactly. Same thing, right? We gotta be an equal opportunity employer. Well, you didn't give yourself a lot of room because it's too small. Right, so what's negative 10 plus 10? Good, 0, right? So what remains on the left side?
4.
Negative 4, right? Yes. Beautiful.
Can't see 3.
And then what do you do on the right side? Oh, number 3, it's negative 10 mm-hmm. minus 4z mm-hmm. equals 28z.
What?
Number 3, it's negative 10 minus 4z equals 28z. Well, yeah, right? That's what it says, 28 plus 10. Good, what's the next step? Kevin, come on.
Yeah, like big robots.
What are you, stuck?
No,
you're just distracted. Yeah.
And then you divide,
the way,
right?
That's perfect.
How can you?
It's a number 3 is a fraction. Yep. So you have negative 4 times x. So what's the inverse of times? Divide. Exactly. So you're going to divide both times by the coefficient, which is which number?
Well, did you get it?
Correct.
Yeah, for
I believe it should be a negative answer.
Let's
double check. See how it's negative 10?
1.5.
It should be negative 10 there. And everything else is good. Andy, can you put up number 3? Because that was beautiful.
Mr. What's the answer for number 1?
It actually should be negative 9.5.
9.5
is the same thing as 9.5.
Oh, yeah, I forgot to put a negative
1. Yeah, you had it there, right? You had it there. Like we talked about before, don't miss those negatives. Yeah, negative 9.5 and negative 9.5. Because that decimal terminates, you could write it as a decimal. If you add as a fraction, that'd be no good. I mean, if the decimal didn't terminate, like if it was 9.5555555555, then I'd need it to be a fraction. But in this case, you'd go either way. Alright, this one has variables on both sides, right? So if they're on the same side, you do the same math to combine them. If they're on opposite sides, we do the opposite math to cancel one out. So which one do you want to cancel? Yeah, good. Plus 4z. That's excellent. Now that we've seen them, most people are almost done with the third problem, and now we've got some work that Andy put up there. Numbers 1 through 3, how are they similar? Yeah.
They have the same variable.
What do you mean?
Like not, they have the same constants. No. They all have like the same, they all have 28.
They all have 28, and?
Negative 10
and minus 4, right? So they all the same numbers come up everywhere. That's definitely how they're similar. What else?
They both lined up the same way.
What do you mean?
10, 4, 28.
Oh yeah, they have the same numbers and in the same order. And even the equal sign kind of is in the same spot. I agree with that too. What else?
Good.
Huh?
They're all equations.
They're all equations. These are all good reasons why they're similar. Now, how about how they're different? Let's dig deeper. Yeah.
Different variables.
Different variables, right? So on the surface, that's the number one thing is X, Y, Z. I use different letters. Even though it looks the same, they're different letters. Let's go even farther than that. What else is different about them?
The variables change from numbers. Like
from sides.
Yeah.
Yeah, they change on sides, right? So like here, there's two of them on this, both on the left side. Here there's two of them, but they're on opposite sides. And here there's only one. Good. Because of that, how does that change? How is the first step different? Like in this one, what was the first step?
Plus 10.
And 10, what's 10 called? A constant, right?
Yeah.
So there were two constants, right? And only one variable. So we needed to cancel one of the constants. So we had all the constants on one side and variables on the other. And then we can do the last step. And what was the last step? Here, what did he do last?
Divide.
We divide by the coefficient, correct?
Yep.
So it's different right at the very first step. Get rid of that constant. Here, these are on the same side, so I always say do the same math, right? And what do I mean when I say we do the same math? We add them. And negative 10 and minus 4, right? They both have y's, so they're like terms, but they're also friends because they both have a negative value to them. So we end up with negative 14y. So this first step was to cancel constant. This first step is to combine like terms. But what's the second step here? What's the last step?
Divide.
Same as the other one.
The last step is always divide.
The last step in these three problems are all the same, right? So they're different at the very start. This one has variables on opposite sides, so I always say, well, they're on the opposite sides, they're the opposite math to cancel one. Right? So really what we're doing is we're taking the inverse, so we're adding 4z to get 32z, and then you divide by the coefficient again. So yeah, they look so similar, but we get such wildly different answers, and it's not because we changed from x to y to z, it's just because we put those letters in different spots. That's very good. Okay, today, we're going to be part of the party planning committee. So, and we have been talking a lot about wanting to use the whiteboards again. We haven't used them in a little while. Maybe like 2 weeks maybe. So this will be nice. Yeah, since we play with the dice. Maybe that was only last week. All right. Here's what we're going to do. You're going to be broken into four groups, okay? Each group has a part of a party that we're going to plan. So you guys, as a class, you are the Point Breakers party planning business, right? And so you're going to plan somebody's wedding. People get paid a decent amount of money to be a wedding planner. And so that's what your job is going to be. So you're going to look at all these different things. What are some things that wedding planners have to think about when you're if you're planning a wedding?
Price.
At what time?
Price for what?
Location.
So the location, right? The hall or the room you're going to rent.
The food.
The food, excellent. You also said the time, right?
Uh-huh.
The time, good.
The furniture.
The furniture, the DJ I heard someone say, or band. The what?
Cake.
The cake, good. So there's all these things that we have to do. So what we're going to do is kind of split up all the roles. So each group is going to have to do something different. One group is going to try to figure out, you know, how many hours should we rent this hall? And also, like Kevin was saying, what time should it start? What time should it end? One group's going to look at which DJ should we rent. Another group's going to look at, you know, how big should the dance floor be so everyone's kind of comfortable. And another one's going to look at, well, based on all these prices, how many people should we invite? You know, what's your cutoff? So you're going to work on your whiteboards. So I'm going to show you your groups. Group one is going to tell you when we see our groups. But group one's going to work at the front. Group two, I believe, is by the computers. Group three will get the backboard. And group four will be over here. So group one and three, you could just grab markers and you're going to work on here. Groups two and four, you're going to have to grab our large boards to write on, okay? All right, this is what I need to see. You're all going to get these small cards, and we're going to follow the RISE program. It's just a word problem. So that's our strategy, right? So what does the R stand for when I say RISE for a word problem?
Read and underline.
Read and underline. Good joke's on, right? Because how many people get to a word problem and then just don't read it? Yeah, not us, right? Because we know that we're not skipping anything. All right, I. Someone besides joke's on. What do I mean when I say I? You forgot? It's all right. What do I do when I say I in RISE? It's the second thing we do. We read, we underline the word problem. What do we do right after that? Azalea, you remember? Say it again?
Is that annotate?
Well, it's like annotate. Annotate's the English version of this. So I underline the question, usually what's given to us in the question.
Identify.
And what do we identify?
The
variable, right? So let x equal number of, you know, cakes that we're going to solve. Or serve, I mean. Okay, S stands for what?
Simplify.
Not simplify, because it's an equation. Solve. And then finally, E? Not equation. Explain it, yeah. So we explain our answer in a sentence. You know, you get, you know, x equals 12. Well, what does that mean when I say x equals 12? All right, so you're going to underline just on this, but everything else you do is going to be on a whiteboard. So everybody in the group has to answer it. So you all have to write down, define your variable. You all have to solve the equation. You all have to put your answer in a sentence. There's two questions on the front. There's two questions on the front. Everyone's going to answer those two questions. All right? Once your group feels like you've got them both done, grab me. I'll check to make sure you have them right. And then on the back has directions for the follow-up question. So, for example, if you're in teams one and team two, you're each going to get an answer, and then you're going to team up on the back to answer the challenge question. And then if you're in groups three and groups four, you're each going to answer your questions. When you both have it done, you're going to team up to do your challenge questions. And when you're done with the front and the back, each group's going to get an envelope with some problems, and I'm going to split you up from your little groups, and you're going to solve these questions, and each question's going to match with a letter, and you're going to try to figure out what math word it's going to spell. All right, so we're going to worry about one thing at a time. And again, if you get stuck and you can't think of things, use the little tricks that we have around the room. You know, if you're stuck on, you know, size of the dance floor, you can't remember what's perimeter area, use like the door to help you remember. You can't remember any of your vocab words, that's fine. All right, so the front board is Stephen Cologne, who's out, Angel and Harold. So you guys are going to be at the front with group one. There are. I think the rain. It does, I know. All right, group two is Joksan, Exalia, and then Stephen R. is out. There we go. Group three, Andy, Alexandria, and Kevin. You're all here, though, right?
Yeah.
Can you give us your group? And group four is Alenic, Stephen P., Edgardo, and Angelica, and they're not here. Angelica's not here. All right, so group one, come up to the front board. Group two, grab. Everyone needs a whiteboard, a marker, and an eraser, and go near the computers. Group three, grab a whiteboard and erasers and go to the back. Group four, everyone needs whiteboard, marker, erasers, and go to the side. Not right now, you don't know. And group four, you guys are over here anyway. Yeah, markers are over here. You guys want to work on the board, on the whiteboard. So you don't need a whiteboard. You and Angel are going to be working on the front. So you have to figure out the question. Yeah. So I want you to rise. So each of you needs to underline the question on the paper that you have, and each of you needs to identify your variable. Yeah, oh yeah, those are laminated. So you can write all, I use them every year. So you can write on
them. But do not charge for the bride. The tour price is $1,700. How many people will be at the wedding? Just before
you to calculate the Make sure you guys underline the question right on here. This is laminated, so you can write all over it. On that, yeah, so like whatever the question is, so in your case. We've used it for.
What do you call it?
We all have the same problem?
Yeah, everyone in group three has the same problem, but you all have the same problem as the other groups. But this way you guys can all work together.
That's the equation.
That's the equation, yeah. That's good, that's perimeter.
The cheapest answer you can find.
So that's your variable. What letter do you want to start with that?
Charges.
So first thing you're going to do is write that down.
Mr.
Just define that variable right away.
Can you
sure.
So the length is...
What makes you think that? Long, yeah, so long and length are the same. $44. Yeah.
So,
long and length. Long
the
So, you guys can work together to try to help each other out here.
So, how would you get the width? What did you multiply it?
You're going to use that formula for perimeter. Alright, slow down, Andy. Let's let them catch up to you.
Plus 99.
So you're gonna you can underline the question here. Well, the question is
you can use H times H because per all.
Right, that's what we want to know.
Equals
363. So you want to work on to figure out the equation. Remember, the goal, it's not a competition. We're not racing.
H. Yeah, what you do next?
The goal here is that everybody understands the problem. Everyone in the group gets it.
So you gotta... I don't even have to tell. Wait, you do. Yeah.
Good. So the first thing you need to do is write down similar to what he did. Define your variable. Good. Oh yeah, that's the right way to set it up.
Why you put minus 150?
Because you got to subtract these two. These two constants on both on one side.
That's the rate of four.
don't know if I have this right or not, but I'm
doing. Well, there's two ways that you could do this, and what you did so
did
far
you
is fine. 225? Yeah, that's fine. Keep going.
You know, subtract 200.
Mom asked me if you did that.
Yeah, it may help yourself going.
Subtract the 250 because they're both constants on the same side.
Don't lose that variable, Harold. So it's not just 45, right?
45.
Because what is that? Because what you're really talking about is $45 for what? Each hour.
Two?
It's all done.
Maybe you're done with number one. There's two questions on everything. Make sure that everyone in the group gets it done before you fly out to question number two. Hi, Steven.
Miss, I'm done.
Make sure everyone in the group, the best way to figure out if you've got it is make sure everyone in the group has the same thing. I'll check when you guys are done with question one and two. Thank you, Steven. Brad.
DJJB.
Who remembers Steven Roldan is in group? Is he in your group?
Yeah.
There you go, sir. And take a... DJJD. The palindrome.
JD.
I got it.
Wasn't that hard?
Awesome. So make sure you guys explain your answer in a sentence. Like, I see a lot of people that are solving the equation, but that number means nothing unless you put it in a sentence. So explain your answer. What does that mean in a sentence?
We have to join.
The second one.
Even before the second one, on the first one, you guys haven't put your answer in a sentence. You got to explain what it means. You say 30 equals W. What does that mean? One quick sentence. That's okay. Things like that, I'll just be careful.
What's the name? Part two, what does
whatever group three is on their answer, we have to put them together.
Yeah.
You know,
Look at how deep I was. Tell me what P means. At the very beginning, what did P mean? Okay, then you have to write that down. P equals P. You can put it right here, it's fine. This way everybody knows, you always define your variable so everyone knows, okay, sure, use P, but did that mean, you know, I don't know, parties? Did you attend 62 parties, or did it mean 62 people are coming? This is nice, by the way. Identify, your work was perfect, 62 people will be at the group. After you guys, so there's two parts. So you've done one part, right? Yeah, so now you gotta do the second one. What does the P minus 2 in parentheses mean in the real world? Why do you think it's written like that in the equation?
It means multiply.
No, but in terms of the wedding and the guests and everything, why would P minus 2 be in parentheses? So you gotta read the word problem and try to think about it. Now, so you have your identified, your solve, your underlined, R-I-S, you're missing your E. What do you have to do?
Oh,
put it in
wait,
a sentence.
I think I know.
What's that?
Is it the bride and groom?
What about, it does have to do with the bride and groom. Now the three of you think about it more. Be a little bit clearer. It definitely has to do with the bride and groom, okay? That's important.
Wait, okay, so...
I'll come back. You guys talk to each other.
Boom!
What's your variable? What does H stand for?
Hours.
So make sure you define that. Right away, that should be the first thing.
So pretty much this.
DJs will cost the same at 5 hours. I like it. Now, you have a dollar sign here. What is that?
And then I had it.
Now it's gone?
Yeah.
That was that. You thought 5 meant money at first?
Yeah.
Good, it is the same at 5 hours. Now try part 2. So you gotta figure out when will DJ Ocho Nueve be cheaper than DJ JD? Good, there are 6 hours. Oh, the wedding is 6 hours. Very good. Now what about part 2?
Wait, DJ Ocho Nueve is the cheaper
one.
The cheaper at first, but then no.
Yeah, so cheaper at first
and
so what?
You don't even give us the link.
Sure it does.
It gives you
the link you just found the way.
Okay, no.
How'd you get it? You gotta show the work.
Multiply the
length.
Yeah, so show your work, and then that makes a lot of sense what you did.
Past 5 hours.
Yeah, you said it doesn't give you the length, but it does. What's the length of this dance floor? 60. What's the width of this dance floor? Yes, you do. You just figured it out a couple seconds ago.
What?
Right? So you're not, you have to use the information you just had to help you get the next step. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Oh, he's back.
I need to
do it.
Ah. What's up? The same one from the last class?
Yeah,
Officer Chimura?
Yeah,
I think you like you guys.
Yeah, he's a pretty cool cop. Yeah, so that would be 1,000.
Well, what's the follow-up question? What's part 2?
No,
you're not. You haven't done part 2 yet.
We've done part 2 already.
On the front. Part 2. So if it starts at 7, what time? How long is this whole wedding and reception?
6
hours, right? So you have to figure out if it starts at 7 at night, what time does it end? And put it in a sentence.
Before.
All right, what do you got for me?
Obviously, Pete goes to 2, which are the people attending the wedding.
So that's right.
And obviously, you gotta kind of subtract the bride and groom because that's what it says.
But why do we subtract them? Are they not coming to the wedding?
No, not that.
So why are we subtracting them? Because what's happening with the bride and groom?
I'm so good at this, man.
They are, but in terms of the formula. Why do we subtract those 2 people from this formula?
Because
you
don't want to set up the wedding.
No, nope, we're setting up the wedding. Yeah. Why don't we need... Why are we subtracting those people? They're still coming to the wedding. It's not like we're subtracting them from the guest list. What could you tell me about what happens with the bride and groom in the word problem? They don't count for what?
For
attending, they attend, but they don't count for what?
To be charged.
To be charged, exactly. Nice, Edgardo, right? Because they get there for free. So you have P minus 2 because there's 62 people coming to this wedding, or a total at this wedding, but 2 of them aren't getting charged. So how many people are actually getting charged?
60.
All right? So that's what the P minus 2 is. Definitely to do with the bride and groom, but it has to do with the fact that those 2 didn't get charged, so they're not on the... And now when group 3 is done, right, group 3?
Yeah.
All right, so now you guys are going to meet up, and you're going to do the challenge problem on the back.
Meet me halfway.
The time's going to end. Nice. Awesome. Group number 8. 1. Group 1 finished everything. Group 2? You figured it out?
Well, I think so.
Yes, before 5 hours. Why before 5 hours?
Because after 5 hours, well, what's the other DJ's name?
DJ JD.
Yeah, DJ JD will be more, like, better.
More better. Well, yeah, you're right.
Because
why would, is it cheaper what? Cost for what?
For every hour.
For every hour, right? So after that 5 hours, very good, because he's at the lower rate. Okay, now you 2 join forces and do the challenge problem on the back. You're going to join forces with them, right? You can't answer that question. What's the question? The final question is...
Each person
needs 4 square feet of personal space to be comfortable on a dance floor, right? 4 square feet are these 2 tiles. That's kind of what I need to be comfortable. Do you know how many people are coming to this wedding?
No.
They do. Do they know how big the dance floor is? They know how big the dance floor is?
No.
But you do.
They know how many people, or you can fuse it.
That's right, so you gotta fuse it. That's exactly right.
We have something that you
want. Okay, based on the number of hours...
That's right.
That's the number of hours. We got something you want. I don't even know how this is working out.
Do you remember the answer?
Okay. And the information about the DJs in group two answered this question together. Which DJ should be hired and explain why? So, how many hours? 6 hours.
Okay.
I know. So, I think DJ JD because, like, he's over here. If DJ Ocho Nueve was hired, you'd be wasting your money because he's better lower than
all. I'm not helping you. You have
and
six,
we have 6 hours.
There.
No hours.
So we're better off with DJ JD. Up there.
Each person.
Alright.
How many people?
You gotta get me.
62,
right?
That's P. 62.
No, no,
no.
Four
free
squared. Mister,
we got it. I write it down. I'll check it in a minute. Is P for how many people,
right? We're not going to write for P. Yeah. Right. 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 Four square feet is like, this, you see these are four squares, each one will fit big. It's just four, four tiles.
Okay. Just four?
Just four.
Higher?
I don't want to put
5'11".
No. Teamwork. Get it.
Okay.
Teamwork.
I feel like when I read it, it makes sense, and then I try to think about it. Should be.
Whoa.
Higher.
Is that heavy, dude?
Should be what?
No.
Should be DJ.
I'll tell you this. The number 62 isn't
DJ
necessary
JD.
Right away.
You want me to
write? You don't need that for the math. You need that just to think about it later, okay?
Okay.
So
each person on the dance floor needs.
But you get it. You know why.
Well, actually, you could use the 62 if you want. There's two ways to do this. You just need to know how many people were going to the dance to the wedding?
62.
60 are in charge, but 62 are going. How big is the dance floor?
1,800
square feet, right?
So it's basically a small class.
DJ.
Yeah.
Wait. Yeah.
So if there's 1,800 square feet of dance floor.
So do we do like
62
plus
82?
And you gotta ask me
why. Why are you adding 4?
I don't know. Should I subtract 4?
No.
Or maybe just not.
Because.
Question.
No. Because we're doing him for Pat. We're like hiring him Pat.
Is there enough people on the? Is there enough space? Or
because
that's all I want to know. Is there enough space for all these people? Everybody wants four square feet.
So think about this. For every 5 people, they take up 20 square feet.
Okay.
So if you multiply it, you end up like getting closer to it.
More.
Right?
Sure. You can set it up as a rate, we've talked about that. Or a ratio.
Math isn't his strong
suit. You know that's not, you know that's true, right?
We're hiring him for more than
that's why this is the challenge follow-up.
I don't know.
4 hours.
Sure we can.
Oh
my.
I think Kevin had a good idea.
I wrote
saying that every 5 people is 20 square feet, but I wouldn't even think of it like that. How many? You're saying every 5 people. How about for 62 people? If you have 62 people, how many square feet of dance floor might you need?
We love this.
You had to think about it.
Hold on, let me see the card.
Present to you?
Alright, let's see it.
Be blind.
You gotta present it to me, sure. I'm ready for your presentation.
So we decided on that DJ, because they said if they're gonna hire it for 6 hours, right?
6 hours? Yeah.
And
okay.
Then we noticed that we were about to hire DJ Ocho Nueve,
right,
which is better less than 5 hours.
That's
it wouldn't
right
make sense to hire him, so we decided to go with DJ JD.
The palindrome.
Ooh. Because we're hiring him for more than 5 hours.
So that's right. That's excellent. Good.
Every 25 feet takes up 100 square feet.
How about when the first bell rings, you go to the bathroom then? All right. Let's do this.
Double it.
Word problems and these type of problems, right? We're going to go thumbs up, sideways, or down?
I think it's 200.
Sideways. Sideways. Up? Yes? Thumbs up, sideways, or down?
I'm probably like this.
For these types of problems, yeah?
Mister.
Up?
Is this the answer? I want to be.
Well, you gotta put it in a sentence. That's just a number. That means nothing to me.
Oh, but it's the answer, right?
I don't know. It doesn't mean anything to me with just a number.
Right.
Okay, this is the challenge, yeah, right? Remember, they just gave the job to me because no one else would like it. Okay, that's the challenge, so you guys put the thumbs up and try the challenge back in. This is the thumbs sideways. Andrew, you can go to the bathroom right now and then come back.
What's
the
question?
What's that?
Yeah.
Sure.
We do not need a bigger dance floor.
We
do not need a bigger dance floor because
we
need a smaller
dance floor. So wait, what are you supposed to do? So
I thought you reminded us, one wacky tacky Wednesday has been canceled. There'll be no wacky tacky Wednesday tomorrow.
He's saying that all morning.
Well, because someone's still going to wear the wacky tacky outfit tomorrow.
Yeah.
They can if they want.
So what's the point of sphere, right? Okay, let's think of it a different way. For you people that don't get it.
So the ticket for the
you want to figure out basically what's our unit rate per person, right? How much space does each person need? Maybe that'll help. So there's 62 people on the dance floor, right? And you each need
So I wrote down, we do not need to buy a bigger dance floor because all the people together only take up 208 square feet.
How'd you get 208?
Now I gotta re-explain it.
That's fine, you gotta explain. Communicating is so important.
So for every 5 people, for every 25 people, it's 100 square feet that they take up. And the area of the dance floor is 1,800.
Thank you.
So, with all the, I think I did something.
So, let's get the Addy, please come to the main office.
Oh, yeah, I know what I did wrong.
Okay, how about this? What's the total size of the dance floor?
It's
1,800. And what is the rate?
Where does it say that?
That was the answer from the other one.
Oh, okay.
Right? So this is why we had to talk to each other.
Yeah, I didn't know that.
And what's the rate? Essentially, it's a one-step equation. What's the rate that we're able to have space? No? That's extra if you need to one of our. Four, right? For what? For what? For person. So 4 feet. So you get 4 square feet per person.
Then
62. You don't need the 62. The 62 will be important later, but not for this. You want to figure out first how many people could fit on this dance floor.
Steven, who said that?
You got to ask them, what was the size of the dance floor again?
Oh, it's 1,800.
So how do you solve that equation?
It's 450.
Okay. Okay, it's 450. I know. But what do these mean?
Is this it?
I was waiting for you.
Yeah.
You got it, buddy.
All right.
Yeah, 450.
For 25,
right, for 25.
There's 62 people, right?
Yeah.
50. And then 60. 60, that's already adding up. That's 240. And then if you add two more people, it'll be 8 squared more feet that they take up. So wouldn't it just...
I see what you're saying. That is the size of a dance floor. They're looking at number of people, and you're looking at the smallest dance floor you could have. Right? Because you don't need a very big dance floor. For 62 people. So how about we'll go with yours first. If P equals 450, what does that mean? How many people can fit on the dance floor?
Make the dance floor smaller?
No, you don't need to make it smaller. The question is, do you need to buy one that's bigger?
No, you do not. That, no, you
don't.
No,
you don't. Why? What does that mean?
Because P equals
450. And you can have...
Or you could just say, like...
How many people could be on this?
62. And just 450 squares.
There's 62.
Is
this tough?
Can be on this.
Right.
But if not, what if 62 people don't show up? What if, like,
what if nobody shows up? Will you still have enough room on the dance floor for everyone to be comfortable?
Yeah.
Do you need to spend the extra money, the extra $1,000 on a bigger one?
No.
You
need to have a number just to answer the question, right?
Well, the number helps to justify your answer. So there's two ways you could do this. One of them is to figure out how many people will fit on the dance floor. And the other one is saying, if I have 62 people, what's the smallest my dance floor could be? And the smallest my dance floor could be is what you were saying. And obviously our dance floor is way bigger than that. So we don't need to buy a bigger one, right? Because we could fit almost 400 more people on this dance floor. It's a huge thing, 60 feet wide, right? Someone said it's the size of this room. This room's like 25 feet wide. So 60 feet wide would be double and a little bit more. Do you need a key to get next door?
No, I'm just trying to figure out what she's doing for her advisor, where her...
Oh, I don't know.
She's got a Chromebook and stuff, it's all Chromebook stuff, so I gotta figure that out.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
I don't know. All right, so put that in a sentence. Do you need to get a new dance floor? And then just, why or why not? Because the communication part, you can't just tell somebody no. That's why the math is important, so you can be like, this is why it's no.
Yeah,
oh,
my God.
Okay, once you've done that, do you guys feel with these types of problems that you're definitely a thumbs up, sideways, or down?
Like a
three quarters up, sideways.
I'm like this.
How about you? And a three quarters up. How about you? Down. Okay. So my three quarters up. I'm gonna give you guys
No.
This one.
No.
I'm gonna keep it with Alexandria. I trust her.
I'm offended.
Don't be offended. That's why you're my 11th favorite student.
11?
Of all of my students, what are you laughing at? 13?
Okay.
Offended.
All right, so Andy, Steven, and Edgardo, you guys are going to... you guys are going to work on this packet. So it's basically just... Right. You don't have to... Each person has to answer every question. This has a group. They all need to get answered. And each answer matches with a letter. And then figure out what word it's going to spell. One more time, I need to pee a little bit. You need to buy a new dance floor.
No,
why not?
I said that because it's young.
I said
that we 450 people.
All right.
You need these back?
Yeah, I'll take those back. So I'm going to move.
Yeah, we're going to keep bringing them.
Alenix and
yes.
Alexandria and Kevin. You three are going to pick another spot to go move to. Maybe somewhere in the back.
Nice.
And then Gardo, no Steven, idea. And Andy, you guys can stay right here. And Andy can distribute some of the problems, or we can just lay them down.
Can you put my blade down on the desk?
Yeah.
Hey, you're literally making me walk.
Let's just
do
that.
All right, which ones have you got so far?
Hold on, this one's called.
So once you solve it, put the letter down. So then you got this one was negative 8. So which answer is negative 8?
Even.
So Q. I'll put a big Q here. And then eventually we're going to spell a word when we put them all together. It's going to be one of our word walls.